Yes, sir.
Sir, we can start the meeting. Other
Yes, sir.
residents will join in between, sir.
No problem whatsoever.
Okay, sir.
Shall I?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, friends. With the permission of the chair, I am modifying my topic from DCO, which is a concept under polytrauma, to the entire polytrauma. Since I was told I have about 40 minutes at my disposal, I thought why not cover the entire topic? Because if we try to focus too much into zoom in our vision into too much, we might miss the broader picture which we are not interested in. So DCO is a very fascinating subject, very often asked in exams, whether it's theory or practical, and it's been sold like a magic wand. So a couple of examples that I would like to give. We have our residents here. About four or five weeks back, we had a polytrauma patient who had come in the middle of the night. Next day morning, the resident tells me that he did a DCO on the patient. So I inquired what exactly he meant by DCO. He meant he put X-sticks for multiple bones. The patient had a bilateral femur, bilateral tibia, an ankle. Went and put an X-fix. So the concept of the resident is X-fix is equal to DCO. When you are putting an external fixator, that means you are doing a damage control orthopedics. Right, there was one more case which was a mangled tibia, distilled tibia with the type 3B open wound. Even for that, the resident is like, we'll do a DCO, we'll put an external fixator. He did that, and when I asked him whether you did a good debridement, he was looking at stars. So for them, they are so focused that when we tell them damage control, that means they automatically imply that means going and putting an X-fix and coming back, nothing else. No, don't bother about the soft tissues, nothing, right? So this is the local vision that we have, DCO. So let us not focus only on this one concept. Let us see the entire thing and see where exactly DCO fits and how this particular concept can be used to treat our patients. Right, so through this presentation, we'll introduce ourselves to the concept of polytrauma. Define what is a polytrauma. Most of us do not know what exactly is a polytrauma. See the pathophysiology behind it. We then go to the concepts, that is early total care, damage control orthopedics, and there are two more concepts, that is damage control nailing and early appropriate care. We need to know each one of these because this may be the life-saving grace in our patient. It is not that we can do any one for all our patients. We need to modify, we need to customize the type of treatment that we do on our patients depending on the physiology. So polytrauma, like we all know, is the largest killer in the world, especially if you take the younger age population. Most of these are in their 20s, 30s. They are most of the time even the sole breadwinners. Okay, and these polytrauma affects these patients and they can die. And there are three times a patient can, after an accident, it's a trimodal peak. So that is an immediate death, that is less than 1 hour. And in most centers, nothing can be done to these patients. These patients die on the road immediately after death. They don't even reach the hospital. So there is nothing I or you can do anything about this. And then there is a late death. The late death is anything after 1 day. So sepsis is one of the major cause of late death. Of course, we all have a role to play to reduce the incidence of late death. And it's the early death, that is the death between 1 hour and 24 hours. That is the first day of life, immediately after accident. That is where we as orthopedic surgeons should become trauma leaders in the way we treat and put our foot down and explain how this particular patient needs to be treated. All these deaths are preventable deaths, the early deaths and late deaths. It is left to the institute to see how it could be prevented. If you go to the definition, definition is very controversial. Different books mention different definitions. Even in conferences, we do listen to various speakers giving different definitions. The definition which is followed by most of the orthopedic surgeon is polytrauma is one bone and one systemic injury. That is one bone with a chest or an abdomen or a head injury. Okay, but if you go into literature, there is no place where this particular definition has been maintained, has been mentioned. It has maybe come with the flow where an orthopedic surgeon is thinking too much about the bone and less about the other extremities. So he's given equal weightage to a bone and a systemic extremity, right? The other definition is a patient with two or more injuries, one of them life-threatening, one of them potentially life-threatening. And this is the definition which is being seen in most of the publications prior to 2010. That is, a patient has two or more injuries of any system. It need not be a bone, and one of them could be life threatening if not intervened properly. And the other subset is two or more regions with injury severity score more than 15. So this is a very apt definition, provided we understand what is injury severity score. Right? To understand what injury severity score is, we need to understand what is AIS, that is abbreviated injury scale, which is the first scoring system for trauma. This came way back in 1971, and it was actually a scaling system. It was a grading system, it was a descriptive system, and not a scoring system. So each region were divided 1 to 7, each one given one label. External means skin, head and face, neck, thorax, abdomen and pelvis, spine and extremities. And depending on the injury that they have, whether it is minor, moderate, severe, critical or unsurvivable, we give a score. So patient with, say, a fracture femur shaft will have a scaling of 6.3 or 6.2. And if we could not know what the scoring is, then we give a score of 9. So remember, this was in 1971, where most of the centers did not have the advanced technologies to diagnose the fractures or maybe a CT and MR. So a score of 9 was ascertained. So we could understand that this is a descriptive classification, and we could not place a patient under any particular score to know whether the patient is doing good or bad. For that, injury severity score was brought about. It was a modification by Baker et al. In 1974. What they did was they took three areas which had bad injuries and they squared the sum of the highest of the three areas. So if the patient is polytraumatized, if all over the body has injuries, we consider which one is the worst among those. So any three, like thorax, abdomen and extremity, we take them and then score each one and then square the maximum. So maximum score could be 75, because each score could max be 5. 6 means unsurvivable. So there is no point in scoring these patients. So maximum score could be 5. 5 square is 25. So 25 into multiplied by 3 regions could be 75. So one, if any injury was unsurvivable part, automatically it becomes 75, immaterial whether the patient had other injuries or not. And the main thing what it scoring system did was it told us a lethal dose for 50% of the population to die. So we realized that patients between 15 to 44 age could survive up to score 40, whereas if it is elder, more than 65 years old, even score of 20 could be lethal in them. But there was a big fallacy in this scoring system. What if, say for example, the patient has a bad liver injury with a spleen injury? So in injury severity score, since liver and spleen both are part of the abdomen, only one could be scored and one took a weightage over the other. So this was taken care of in the new injury severity score, where some of the squares of three most severe injuries, irrespective of the zones, whether it is the same region or different region, irrespective, first label all the injuries in the body, see which three are maximum and then square it. So this was done and this proved to be a changer, where we realized whether the patient could be a moderate injury or a severe injury. And NISS score, if you can understand, could always be equal or higher than ISS, could never be lower. So with this, the current definition in polytrauma was formed. This was a consensus definition brought about the multicentric great trauma surgeons coming together. They deliberated for over 9 months and they came out with a definition. This is called the Berlin definition. This they proposed in 2014 and is the current definition that could be used for any polytrauma patient. So current definition is two injuries that are greater or equal to 3 on the abbreviated injury score. So we have moved away from the injury severity score, that is ISS, and we have taken into consideration now the AIS. And any two injuries, if their score is more than 3, plus any one of the following. So that is two injuries plus they should have one of the following, that is hypotension less than 90 millimeters, unconscious GCS score less than or equal to 8, acidosis with the base deficit less than or equal to 6, coagulopathy or age more than or equal to 70 years. So if the patient has any one of these and has two injuries in the body with the score more than 3, he could be labeled as polytrauma. So please note, this does not mean the patient need to have a bony injury. The patient may have a bone injury or not. Even two different systems definitely can be labeled as polytrauma. So we need to understand that if an isolated TBI patient comes, no matter how mangled the limb looks like, we can't call it a polytrauma. Similarly, if a patient comes with a femur and a shaft fracture, both being bad, even then we can still label it as polytrauma, because two injuries are present with AIS more than 3. So a systemic part need not be present or only present without a bony part. Either way, it could be a polytrauma. This we need to put in the back of our mind. So why these concepts are required is, if you go back in the history, until about 1980s, most of the patients that had fractures were put on tractions and splints. They were just conservatively managed because the results with surgical techniques were extremely poor. Plus, the implants were of not good quality. So they were considered too sick to be operated upon. That is, we just can't operate on these patients because they are very sick. They will die intraoperatively or after the surgery. So there is no point in operating on these patients. That was the concept before 1980s. But 1980 onwards, with little better advancement in anesthetic techniques, rehabilitation techniques, and ICU techniques, the surgeons become little more exposed. So they were able to treat these patients. And hence the phrase was, these patients are too sick not to operate on. That means, if I don't operate a polytrauma patient, the patient is not going to survive. So it is too sick. So my operation will help the patient to improve. That is the concept 1980 onwards. This was by Dr. Larry Bone from US. So what they suggested was early as well as definitive stabilization of long bones. Please note, it is only of long bones. And when we are talking of long bones, it is only the axial long bones. The advantages proposed were, it reduced ARDS, because once these patients were out of bed, they could be rehabilitated much better, and hence the chances of ARDS was much lower. Reduction of ARDS is equal to reduction of chances of multiple organ failure. Fat embolism was lesser because most of the time they used unreamed nails, and in those patients in whom nailing was not done, because of the constant movement of the femur fractures, it led on to fat embolism, the conservatively treated patients. The mobilization, of course, reduced the chances of deep vein thrombosis, and overall these patients had better function because these patients could be mobilized early. So this was the dictum, early total care. Go in, go early, and definitively fix all the long bones. This went on for about a decade. Most of them were very excited about what they were doing. But on retrospective analysis, they found that it increased the mortality rate. So when it was taught why mortality rate should increase, we orthopedic surgeons, being the orthopedic surgeons that we are, we always blamed it on someone else. We told that the patient already had fat embolism, so his pathophysiology is poor, there's nothing much I could do. Or we blamed the intensivist, telling their rehabilitation is not good, they are not able to take care of the patient properly, and hence they died. So we tried to shirk away from the responsibilities and blaming others. Then when properly analyzed, we realized that these patients did not die because of poor rehab or did not die because of fat embolism, but they died because of multiple organ dysfunction syndrome or septicemia. Now, in both of these conditions, it is the surgeon who is at fault. Why did this happen? This was studied. So we all know the trauma triad of death. In a severe blood loss situation, that is a situation in which most of the polytrauma patients are, coagulopathy, acidosis, and hypothermia. If these three exist together, it will lead to death. Why does this happen? Because once there is trauma, no matter how trivial the trauma is, there will be release of pro-inflammatory mediators in the body. Now, these pro-inflammatory mediators, since they enhance the inflammation, it could lead on to systemic inflammatory response syndrome. This could lead on to multiple organ dysfunction syndrome and death. What is also notable is, once there are pro-inflammatory mediators, the body also releases counter-regulatory anti-inflammatory mediators. That means the body tries to reduce the inflammation by itself. So it reduces the immune response of the body. So a patient for a certain period of time could also be in a hypoimmune state. Now in this, if there is even a minor chance of any infection, it would lead on to septicemia, because the body cannot respond to what is happening. So these two things, pro-inflammatory mediators leading on to multiple organ dysfunction syndrome and counter-regulatory inflammators leading on to septicemia. These were the two causes of death which are occurring in most of the patients who underwent early total care. So this was the graph. The SIRS peaks, and there's a corresponding graph with peaking of counter-anti-inflammatory regulatory system. So depending on what the patient has, whether he has an increased peak on the pro-inflammatory or anti-inflammatory, there could be SIRS or septicemia ultimately leading on to that. If both of them go parallelly and come down over a period of time, there will be recovery and the patient will do good. So like I said, SIRS is tumor necrosis factor alpha, interleukin 1 and interleukin 6. The increase factors leads on to pro-inflammatory mediators leading on to SIRS and MODs, whereas counter-entry inflammatory regulatory response is interleukin 4, 10, and 13. They should be decreased to cause hypoimmune response leading on to septicemia. The same in that form. So now comes the question of first hit and the second hit. What is this concept of first and the second hit? The first hit is the trauma. Once the patient has an accident, it is the first hit. Once again, doesn't matter how trivial it is, but that is the first hit. Once that hit occurs, automatically the body pours in pro-inflammatory mediators to reduce the hit. And then the second hit could be any of the following. It could be the surgery that we conduct on the patient, even a blood transfusion, hypoxemia which the patient can have, fat embolism due to any fracture shaft femurs, or even pain. If there is increased pain and the patient is not able to tolerate pain, this could itself be the second hit. That means something is hitting the patient's body. Whether it is us as surgeons due to surgery or other interventions like blood transfusion, or the patient per se where he is not able to perceive the pain, it could lead on to second hit. So what happens is, if there is a first hit and if it is less in quantity, the body will be able to respond to it and reduce the chances of inflammation and lets the patient heal properly. But if there is a second hit and that increases the inflammatory mediators, the body just cannot do anything. This leads on to multiple organ dysfunction syndrome. So we as surgeons should take care that we do not provide the second hit to the patient who is already hit first time by the trauma. So this is where damage control orthopedics comes into picture. The term damage control is borrowed from US Navy. So during war, if a ship is hit by a missile, there will be a huge crater in the ship. Now remember, during war, the ship is in the middle of the sea or ocean. So there is no way that people can come to it and repair whatever structures have been damaged. So all the points done to see to it that the hit is reduced and the vessel doesn't sink. So what they do is they squadron off the entire area where there is a damage and see to it that this ship safely sails back to the dock where the damaged structures could be repaired. All the measures that they take is a part of damage control. Now the same concept is borrowed over. The patient is already hit badly, so we need to see to it that the patient sails through and reaches a point where we could go in and do things that are ultimately required. So initially, we just need to see to it that the patient is able to sail through the phase and reach a certain point. So if you have to define damage control, it is to do as little as possible, but sufficient enough to save the patient's life. That is, we need to do something to the patient. It should be little but sufficient so that the patient is saved. We can't do over aggressive treatment, nor can we be just sitting on the chair waiting for things to happen by itself. So there are four phases in this. In the acute phase, we do only life-saving procedures. That is, if a procedure is not carried out, the patient will die immediately. These procedures are carried out, like a bleeding artery. We need to go in, take care of that. A pelvic injury with a bleeding vessel. We need to go in, put an external fixator and take care of the bleeding by either by tamponade or ultra embolization anyway. So these all come under acute phase. In the second phase, control of hemorrhage, which is minor, that is indirect control of hemorrhages. This is by temporary stabilization of major skeletal fractures. Please note that this is major skeletal fractures. DCO does not mean go and put external fixator to each and every part of the body that has been injured. All right. And at the same time, we need to take care of the soft tissues. That is, the management of soft tissue injuries occurs at the same time. This cannot be taught in different way, that the bone is different from the soft tissues. No, that doesn't happen. We need to take care of both at the same time. In the third phase, the patient is monitored into ICU, resuscitated, and seen to it that his physiological parameters go to normal. And then the fourth phase starts, which is definitive fixation of the fractures. So a patient is taken in different levels depending on where he is. If he requires any life-saving measures, yes, do it immediately. If there are no life-saving measures, we could go and splint the fractures, external fixators for major skeletal injuries, at the same time take care of soft tissue, shift the patient to ICU, resuscitate, rehabilitate him, get him back to his normal physiology, and then go and address definitively. So emergency procedures could be done anytime. There is no waiting period here, because if we do not act immediately, the patient is going to die. Whereas for any other injuries which are not considered life-saving, there is a time span in which it could be done. We have seen that first 48 hours is all right. from 48 hours to 5 days, the pro-inflammatory mediators are at its peak. Also, the counter-anti-inflammatory mediators are at its peak. At this time, it is preferable not to do any surgical procedures. At this time, if we go and do any procedure, it would be like a second hit to the patient. So first 2 days, that is first 48 hours, any injuries could be treated. Upper limb preferably splinted. There is no advantage of putting an external fixator in upper limb fracture. In a lower limb, if it is a below knee, it could also be splinted with a slab or any splints. Even in fractured tibia or an ankle, there is no advantage of putting an external fixator. Now, we are talking only from polytrauma situation and not any other situation. Whereas if it is a femur, an external fixator is mandatory because it is extremely difficult to immobilize the limb in a slab for a femur fracture or a thomas splint. It's very difficult to immobilize the fractures perfectly. Number two, it becomes extremely difficult to rehabilitate a femur shaft fracture who is already on a splint. So it is much easier to put an external fixator. Then ICU rehab becomes easier. The patient can turn to the lateral side or even prone if required with an external fixator on. And pelvis, if there's a fracture which is causing problems, then of course an external fixator is mandatory since we cannot keep the binder for a long time. So an external fixator goes in. So we need to note damage control means femur external fixator and pelvis external fixator. It does not mean external fixator to all the fractures in the body. So is there any way that we can label that this particular patient is sick and we cannot do an early total care, we need to do a damage control? How do we understand? How do we judge and label a patient? So this is the chart which needs to be followed. If you follow the chart, the patient could be brought under stable, borderline, unstable, or in extremis. In extremis means these patients most likely will not survive. So there's nothing much anyone could do. 40 to 50% of our patients are stable. That is, they have polytrauma, but their physiological parameters are normal since polytrauma occurs in a younger population and hence the body is able to withstand the insult and hence they may be stable. The unstable ones are hardly about 10%. It is the remaining 40 to 50% of the patients who are actually borderline. That means they might not be normal when they present to us, but over a period of time with good resuscitation, they might become stable or vice versa. When they present to us, they are perfectly fine. All their parameters are normal. But the moment we take a decision to shift them to the OR and do the procedures, the patient might slowly start sinking. So these are the set of borderline patients. What we need to do is once again look into their parameters. The first three are the triad of death. Shock, that is acidosis. Shock leads on to acidosis. So we know triad of death is acidosis, coagulation, and hypothermia. The same things we need to look for. And then soft tissue injuries are given a score. So whether soft tissue in this sense is any other systems also, lung functions, chest scores, the abdominal trauma, pelvic trauma, and the extremities. So all these things we need to grade and see where the patient falls in, whether he is stable, borderline, unstable, or in extremis. So once we label these, stable patients would go to OR for early total care. Whatever the fractures are there, we can go in early and do a definitive fixation. Whereas if the patient is in extremis, the patient goes to an ICU for rehab. There's no for resuscitation, sorry, because there's nothing much we could do by taking them to OR. The patient is going to lose his life. So try to resuscitate it and see to it whether the patient could make it. We could use external fixators, say for pelvic injuries, which are life-saving procedure in the ICU itself. No need to take them to an OR. If the patient is an unstable, it is directly for a damage control orthopedic. So stable ETC, unstable DCO. If it is borderline, we need to resuscitate and keep repeatedly evaluating them whether they are stable, whether they go towards the stable side or whether they go towards the unstable side and follow appropriately. So early total care, if and only if pH is more than 7.25, base deficit is more than minus 5.5, the lactate is less than 4. Lactate less than 4 and trending down. That means the shock is improving. Whenever there is a shock, it leads to the tissues leading on to lactic acidosis. So lactates coming down is a good sign. That means the shock is getting improved and these patients are getting stabler and hence they can undergo an early total care. And the patient needs to be normotensive without the use of any pressors. So all these four, it is not one of these four, all these four needs to be met and they could be met within 8 hours of the injury. So the patient comes immediately following injury, say within 1 hour. If the patient is unstable because of any of these parameters, we don't need to tell that this patient is unstable and we need to do a DCO. We could wait up to 8 hours at any point of time. If the physiological parameters improve, we could do an early total care. Otherwise, we could do a damage control orthopedic. So in borderline, the criteria for evaluation of borderline patient is a polytraumatic score of 20 or more with an AIS of 2. If there is an associated abdominal or pelvic trauma with hemodynamic shock, which was told in the previous slide, an ISS of 40 or more, if there is a bilateral lung condition on an initial chest radiograph, there is a concept called evolving lung injury. So the patient might not complain of chest trauma, but because of the ARDS, there will be continuous contusion, and over a period of time, after 24 hours, if we get a CT done, we could see significant lung contusion. These patients do poorly. And if the initial mean arterial pressure, pulmonary arterial pressure is more than 24, and if we take this patient for surgery during nailing, if the pulmonary artery pressure raises by 6, it is a bad sign. So we need to stop it at that. So all these tells us that our patients are borderline. So with regards to timing, we have now understood when to do an ETC and when to do a DCO. That is when the patient present to us immediately. Now the concept is, when do we actually operate on these patients? Or is it that if the patient is fine, if the patient is stable, we can go in any time and operate? No, it is not. It once again depends on the physiological status of the body. So day one, we could do any surgery that is required, including life-saving surgeries or damage control or early total care. 48 hours onwards, that is after 2 days, up to day five, we have realized that this is the phase of hyperinflammation. The pro-inflammatory mediators are at its peak. So day two to day five, that is after 48 hours and less than 120 hours, no surgery needs to be done unless it is a life-saving surgery. So no major surgery has to be done in this time. Then comes day five to day 10, which is the window of opportunity. Any surgery could be done. It is any definitive fixations, any other surgery could be done from day 5 to day 10, because by this time, the pro-inflammatory and the counter-anti-inflammatory mediators have come back to its normalcy. So the patient's physiological status is normal. We could go and do any surgery. Post day 10 is a phase of immunosuppression, and hence day 10 to day 20, no surgery needs to be done. And 21 days onwards, any surgery could be done. Now these all are for with regards to polytrauma. It does not hold good for an isolated injury. So the window period for us is less than 2 days, day 5 to day 10, and anything after 3 weeks. So any other time frame, if the patient is in, we better not do any surgery, which could act like a second hit, and it might insult the patient's physiology. So the advantages that was proposed and is seen with the damage control orthopedic is it limits second hit, obviously. And it allows us to definitively plan a polytrauma. Like a patient has come on day two, we could do a damage control since it is more than 8 hours already. And we could plan it out that on day six, if the patient is stable, I'm going to do this type of definitive fixation. And so it gives a surgeon the time and better adaptability to plan out the polytrauma management. And if we do a DCO, the overall stay in the ICU reduces, because in DCO, we do take care of pelvis and the femur with an external fixator. So ICU rehabilitation becomes much easier and faster, and hence the overall stay is reduced as compared to conservatively managed. We are not comparing here with an early total care, but with conservative managed. Say for example, we have not done any external fixator, we have only splinted all the limbs. In these patients, they might tend to stay in the ICU longer. Definitely reduced incidence of ARDS, since there is reduced chances of fat embolism, and hence reduced MODS, that is multiple organ dysfunction syndrome. And shorter stay leads to better rehab. But there are disadvantages with damage control. This we need to understand. Damage control is not like a magic wand that we do it in all patients and they do good. So we tend to call all our patients borderline. Now this especially happens if you see the literature, there is a big fight off between the US surgeons versus the European surgeons. The difference is because in Europe, the protocol is if there's a polytrauma patient, the senior needs to come and operate. So post their duty hours, they would tend to wait, and hence damage control is applied. Any patient who comes in the evenings or slightly before the duty shift hour timings, they tend to tell that this patient is borderline. We would do it damage control, and an external fixator could be applied by any resident, and hence the patient is pushed towards damage control. Or on the other side in US, where most of it is because of private payment, the doctors tend to tell that these patients are not borderline, we'll do an early total care and tend to fix them as early as possible. So this caused the patients, for us, it blurred which patients are borderline, and hence the proper set of patients did not get the required treatment, and hence overall they seem to be a failure. The second part was overemphasis on damage control. Like we told, use X-Fix as the modality everywhere. Like we could see in this case, this patient has a femur with tibia. External fixator was used both for the femur as well as tibia, which is not required. We could fix the tibia individually and then put a fixator for the, we could fix the external fixator for femur and then splint the tibia with a slab or something. So damage control does not mean an external fixator. We should not be using external fixator in all the bones or all the regions that have been injured. So this brought to the newer concept of damage control nailing. If you could see 1980 to about 1990, 1992, it was early total care. From about 1992 onwards to about 2005, it was damage control. And then the debate started, which is better. And this concept came out in 2007 by Higgins et al. It is damage control nailing. What was found that, what was the fear of treating these patients early? The fear of treating, especially the femur early, was if you put in a nail, it causes fat embolism. Due to reaming, there's increased chance of fat embolism, and fat embolism will lead on to ARDS and death. So this was what was thought. The second problem was most of these are bad polytrauma patients, and hence positioning on fracture table becomes difficult because the anesthetist might not like these patients to be on fracture table with the traction on the leg. And say if there is a bilateral femur shaft fracture, more often than not, it will take more than 4 hours, which is the time limit for damage control. It will take more than 4 hours to internally fix bilateral femur. These three problems were associated with femur fractures. This was taken care of by damage control nailing. In damage control nailing, what is done is an unreamed retrograde nail is used and only distally locked. So unreamed nail took care of the problems with the reaming. Since it is a retrograde nail, it is positioned on non-fracture table, and hence the issues with traction is not is no more a problem now. And since it is only distally locked through the jig, proximal locking, which is free end, is not done. We are not wasting much time. So even if the patient had a bilateral shaft femur, we could still do out this procedure and finish the procedure, say, in about 1 hour. So an unreamed retrograde nail, which is only distally locked to the jig, is done. And once the patient is stabilized, say day 6 or day 7, it could be exchanged with a broader size reamed nail. In most cases, an unreamed nail would be a narrow nail, like we could see in the previous picture. And this is exchanged with a proper reamed nail, once again retrograde, since we anyway have to remove the nail, and then locked both proximally and distally. The advantage with this procedure is the femur are stable. With both the femur stable, it becomes extremely easy to resuscitate these patients. Even an external fixator will not give this type of stability, and it is practically impossible to fix a proximal, say a high subtrochanteric fracture with an external fixator and expect it to be in good stability. So that was the concept of damage control nailing. And then comes the concept of early appropriate care. This was once again from US, Valier et al., their group, where they brought in a different concept for us to understand. So if a patient is well resuscitated within 36 hours, we now know that the first pro-inflammatory mediator takes about 48 hours to go to its peak. So before that, if a patient has presented, so that is if the patient has presented within 36 hours, I still have 12 hours to work on this patient, to act on this patient, to do whatever is necessary. So if a patient presents within 36 hours, and if the lactate is normal, pH is normal, and base excess is normal, we could do something called early appropriate care. What is early appropriate care? So we do DCO when parameters are not there, of course. And when everything is there, we do early appropriate care. In early appropriate care, we fix all the axial skeleton and the long bones, that is spine, pelvis, and long bones. So this was a new concept which is brought about, where a spine is fixed as early as possible. Pelvis is internally fixed. We are not talking of an external fixator. We're talking of an internal fixator, and the long bones is only femur. So if the patient has a spine injury, a pelvic injury, and a femur shaft, all these are internally fixed within 48 hours. If the patient presents within 36 hours and all parameters are normal. The advantage is with the spine, pelvis, and the femur taken care of, the patient's ICU rehabilitation becomes much easier. Imagine a patient who has a spine fracture it is difficult for him to, he has to be lying supine. It is difficult for him even to turn across. And if this patient sinks, in the sense his physical parameters become bad over a period of time, the patient ends up with bed sore. So by fixing the spine and the pelvis and the femur, it is easier for us to make it on lateral position or even in prone position. So friends, what we need to understand, the damage control is not a magic wand. The treatment is a spectrum. It is early total care on one side, damage control on the other side, depending on how the patient's physiological profile is. And the patient is doing good, there is a newer concept of an early appropriate care, provided we as an institute are surgeons. We have surgeons who could go in and fix spine and the pelvis on day one. So depending on the patient's parameters and the facilities available at the institute, we need to take a position. It is not a one size fits all that I will do damage control in all my patients, or I will do early total care in all my patients. No. The pathophysiology is dependent on multiple factors. We need to think about all this. We as surgeons should not be the cause for the second hit. And just to remind, day 2 to day 4 is no touch. The window of opportunity is day 5 to day 10. So anything less than 48 hours and more than 120 hours, that is day 5. So all of them, early total care, damage control and early appropriate care are necessary. We as surgeons need to understand this and apply this depending on what the patient needs. Thank you.
Thank you, Shailesh sir. Anyone wants to ask?
Any?
Any resident wants to ask the question to sir?
They can unmute themselves.
Yes, sir, if they want to ask. No, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Shailesh, sir.
Shailesh, any role of avoiding fat embolism and role of methylprednisolone?
Sir, if we look at the literature, it is both views are taken. So there are centers which have been giving methylprednisolone, telling it reduces the inflammatory mediators and hence reduces, it doesn't reduces fat embolism per se, but it reduces the inflammatory reaction that occurs in the lungs. But there has not been any say RCTs or meta-analysis which conclusively proves that it occurs. So mm-hmm. It is left to the institutes to decide whether they need to do with that or not. The only issue with the methylprednisolone in the polytrauma is with the pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory mediators at its peak. If we try to reduce the inflammation, the patient might end up in hypoinflammation leading on to septicemia, especially if there's yeah. open injury. So yeah. We need to weigh all this and then decide whether the patient does better with fat embolism or not.
Secondly, you are talking about the interleukin 6 and other thing. How they are available in the periphery? Because these investigations are not available even in good centers.
Yes, sir. Interleukin-6 is a marker, but the way we label the patient as stable, unstable, or borderline doesn't take into consideration interleukin-6 values. It is only clinical judgment which needs to be done with laboratory findings like lactate, base deficit, and hypotension, all these. It does not take inflammatory mediators as values because it has been proved that especially interleukin-6 can be raised in multiple scenarios and there is no cutoff line which could decisively tell whether this patient is doing good or bad. It's a very wide range. So that is not taken into consideration for labeling the patient as stable or unstable.
Because these investigations are not available everywhere.
Definitely, sir. It's not.
That is a problem.
So easiest is to do a serum lactate and arterial blood gas. That tells us pH, yeah. That tells us lactate, that tells us base deficit. These three are the most important. And along with that hypotension, if all these are good, we are good to go ahead and fix these fractures.
If there are no questions, we can ask Shailesh. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot for inviting me, sir. Thanks.
Yes, it was nice. Thank you, sir. We'll try to contact you for some other topics.
Okay, sir. Sure. No issues.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I'm ending the meeting now. Thank you, sir.
Thanks. Okay, sir.